Ladies and gentlemen, can you please stand?
It is good to come together, to open our hearts and souls to the presence of God, Spirit and each other. We join in thanksgiving for this shared experience, for in doing so, we proclaim that no one shall be excluded from visiting this National Memorial to spiritualists. It is in this place of natural beauty that everyone will be made welcome, able to pay their respects, to sit in silence, to send out thoughts and prayers in remembrance of their loved ones, friends and others who have served their country in times of conflict and in peace. Would you please be seated? As President of the Spiritualist National Union, and also personally, may I extend a very warm welcome to everyone from all parts of Britain who have made a special effort today to attend this dedication service, and your support in every way is very much appreciated by the Union. It is from all walks of life that we've gathered here to dedicate this National Memorial in memory of all those spiritualists who have served and paid the ultimate sacrifice, and also those who continue to serve in the British, the Commonwealth and the Allied Armed Forces. At the same time, we should also remember with pride and gratitude all those spiritualists who also served their country in a civilian capacity, many of whom too lost their lives along with their family, loved ones and friends. Therefore, we should all quietly reflect upon the privilege of actually being here, so that the love which is generated and received may be used for the benefit of all. Shall we join together by singing the first hymn? God of the granite and the rose, soul of the sparrow and the bee, the mighty tide of being flows through countless channels, Lord, from thee. If you like to stand, you can do. I think. Lucy, he said, I think you did very well there to keep up in time. We had a bit of a hiccup. Now I'd like to invite the Vice President Spiritual of the Spiritualist National Union, Minister Judith Seaman, to give us her invocation. Judith.
Great Spirit, giver of life, we gather together today to dedicate this obelisk, its structure created from the natural resources of Mother Earth, but erected in love and gratitude to the many who have served and given in fulfillment of our second principle, the Brotherhood of Man. We have come together today to pay tribute to all who have given of themselves in service to their country and to their fellow men. Some of you here present today may have at this moment in your minds personal memories of people who you know who are close to you, who served and perhaps gave their lives for their fellow man for the service of their country, and we think of them now. But we remember all who have served in any capacity to try to bring peace to our world. As spiritualists, we know that death is not a final ending of life, but rather a new stage of the continuous existence of the soul. Therefore, today is a celebration of life and life eternal, encompassed in the symbology of the structure of this memorial. Infinite Spirit, we pray that the men and women who hold the power of nations will be moved and guided to seek peace in our world, and that all mankind will feel that desire stir within them. So here, with these trees as sentinels, and the flowers, like silent watchers, keep their guard on this hallowed place. But we know the souls of all who die move into eternity. The spirit is free to continue its eternal journey. Father, we ask that here today you will bless us with your love and wisdom, that we may build peace in our own lives. In your name, amen.
Thank you, Judith. Ever since the advent of modern spiritualism in 1852, spiritualists did have much of a choice, because at that particular time, apart from in America, there was very few conflicts going on in the world. And it was only around 1914 when spiritualists suddenly realized they had a part to play, and in the past they'd always been able to ignore the practical problems of war. In practice, spiritualists are against war and violence, as these are contrary to their belief in the brotherhood of man. Killing another person under any circumstances is unacceptable, since it ends a person's life prematurely. The killing of the body cannot, of course, destroy the soul, but it is to be condemned for three reasons. Firstly, life on earth is an important aspect of the whole life of spirit. It is a period where the soul learns from its experiences on earth important lessons as part of its eternal progress. It is not a period of existence that should be cut short by others or the individuals themselves. Secondly, a sudden death for which the individual is not prepared may temporarily harm the surviving personality. It could initially cause shock, from which it will take quite a long time to recover. And thirdly, killing was construed by many spiritualists to be harmful to the spiritual development of the killer himself or herself. Therefore, the outbreak of war in 1914 presented spiritualists and other religions with a dilemma. Whilst the majority of people supported the war effort, there was a minority who did not. Quite a number of spiritualists, Quakers, Jehovah's Witnesses became conscientious objectors, and they were often shunned and humiliated by society as well as by their family and friends. Many were put into prison, and some were made to work in munitions factories. Others were forcibly enrolled into the army, where they underwent almost continuous punishment for refusing combat duties. And they were given jobs such as stretcher bearers, dealing with those who had died or been injured, bomb disposals, and various other similar tasks. A number of spiritualists at that time were members of Parliament, and they also had very difficult decisions to make. However, most spiritualists, at least passively, believed in the aims of the war. And this was highlighted in 1915, when the Two Worlds magazine sponsored a spiritualist motor ambulance fund. And this raised over £900, and from this amount was purchased 6 ambulances, which were then donated to the War Office. After the war had finished, many spiritualists supported the large number of peacemaking organisations that sprang up in order to preserve the peace. But unfortunately, that did not happen, because in 1938, the movement was again split by the controversy between supporters of the war and the pacifists. The Council of the Spiritualist National Union even issued a manifesto in which they declared that, whilst recognising the folly of war, it is the duty of spiritualists to serve the cause of liberty in any and every way which conscience dictates, by assisting the weak and oppressed. The majority accepted the choice between the two evils, but a minority of over 61,000 persons, which was far more than in the previous war, did in fact become conscientious objectors. Many of the spiritualist platform workers claimed exemptions, and they were issued with passes to visit churches. And a lot of these churches were on the south coast, and this was a prohibitive zone that covered that part area of England. And they had passes in order to go and visit the churches and take services. The union itself had about 60 ministers at that time, who were also exempted from service. So it was a hard time for everybody. We always remember the spiritualists, especially the women, who throughout the various conflicts kept the doors of our churches open, despite the difficulties entailed. In addition, due to the absence of the men who were fighting, they also took on other tasks which had previously been done by the men. They worked on the land, they worked in the hospitals, in the munition factories, in the catering establishments, in civil defence. They helped to clear the damage caused by bombing raids on many of our major cities and some of our churches. And they also raised funds and did other things to provide extra comforts for those who were serving in the armed forces. And the list of achievements of the lady spiritualists, the women spiritualists, is endless. The common factor of support united everyone together, and we should be remembering them, as many of these valiant workers gave their lives too. Without their support, where would we be today? This national memorial has been purposely designed to reflect the various attributes that spiritualists required during the many conflicts of the past, as well as today's current situations. The reddish-brown stone denotes the strength, love and stability that all concerned needed in body, mind and spirit to cope with the many situations which were beyond their control. The lighter stonework symbolises the inner peace of mind which we all desire, together with a clearer consideration and understanding of all mankind before putting destructive thoughts into actions. The obelisk symbolises all mankind reaching out to God and Spirit through their own spiritual awareness. This obelisk is placed in a circle which is symbolic of eternal life, where there is no beginning and where there is no end. The seven rays on the floor of the monument symbolize the power of spirit reaching out to all mankind, into which everyone may enter, and also the merging of the two worlds of spirit and matter. As we enter the circle, we become aware of the words light, nature, and truth carved in the stone beneath our feet, which reflects that we are all motivated by the power of spirit as it touches the soul of every individual and every atom that forms the universe. Light is motivated by the power of spirit. Nature is motivated by the power of spirit. And truth is also motivated by the power of spirit. And the wall which surrounds us, while symbolizing protection, it also denotes the boundaries of our knowledge and understanding. On both sides of the wall are carved in stone for time immemorial the seven principles of SNU spiritualism. The lettering is in gold, which symbolizes eternal progress for all mankind, irrespective of their color, caste, or creed. It is for over 100 years that these seven principles have sustained spiritualists throughout the world, both in times of conflict as well as in times of peace. And I think it will be most appropriate today if we all joined together and stated them. Would you like to join with me? The fatherhood of God, the brotherhood of man, the communion of spirits and the ministry of angels, the continuous existence of the human soul, personal responsibility, compensation and retribution hereafter for all the good and evil deeds done on earth, eternal progress open for every soul. Let us in thanksgiving to all who have served, yet seeking to realize in full the implications of this sacred act, raise our consciousness to a higher spiritual level. As we who are gathered here today, in the sight of God and the spirit world, and in unity with our friends, both seen and unseen, become blend together and become instruments of that mighty force we call God, as we dedicate this national memorial in the name and religion of spiritualism. We therefore unveil. And we dedicate this memorial to the service and worship of God, in memory of all spiritualists who have served and continue to serve in the British and Commonwealth Armed Forces, and all spiritualists who have served their country in times of conflict. We also dedicate the ground upon which this memorial stands as a consecrated place of peace, where people who have lost loved ones may come and remember them with love and affection, and also as a focal point where we all, with gratitude and thanksgiving, can remember more fully what it cost others in order to give us what we have and enjoy today. May all come here so that the many-faceted light of spirit can embrace them in its rays, so touching their souls and bringing about within them an inner understanding which hopefully will give them the peace and the harmony they desire. Would you like to stand, please?
They shall not grow old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
Would you please be seated?
Thank you.
now like to ask Minister Eric Hatton, who is the SNU Honorary President, to say a few words to you on behalf of past servicemen and women. Eric.
Ladies and gentlemen, friends, it would be very, very difficult for me, no less than it would for anyone at any time in these years that have passed since the World War, to encompass and to appreciate all the things that those who served our country and indeed who gave their lives for the conflicts that they unfortunately were often forced to participate in. I'm sure each of you have your own recollections of people you have known. Some of them will be lesser, as it were, in stature than others, but all are important, not only for their contribution, but in the eyes of the Great Spirit, for whatever they have done. Like myself, there are times when we all abhor war or conflict of any kind and the taking of life. But equally, there are times when necessity, both in our world and particularly in our country, demands that we shall sacrifice something, even the principles that we hold dear. As I have said, it is difficult to even encompass those we have known. And if I mention one or two names which are, as it were, illustrious in the spiritualist movement, I hope you will forgive me. It is only to remind us that these people stood out not only as being part of the services to which they represented, but also because they fought our cause, the spiritualist cause, most valiantly and dedicatedly. And if I mention someone named Gordon Higginson and Albert Best and Harry Edwards, Lord Dowding, Pongo Mason in recent years as an air pilot, Douglas Bader, and one who was in part of our community in the West Midlands, Captain Ernest Gill, and I'm sure I've missed many others. But you see, it wasn't just a question as to whether they were spiritualist, but that was their fundamental and proud belief. It was because they would do anything, as it were, to overcome tyranny, which some of us unfortunately experienced years ago. No less than there is tyranny in the world today, to which my young friend will undoubtedly make reference to. And whilst we remember, and here is an example that anyone coming here, no less than ourselves, will pay tribute through what has been dedicated in way of memorial to them. Nevertheless, we will each remember not only the privilege of knowing them, if knowing them we did, but also to know of them. And whilst I've mentioned illustrious names, by no means do I forget those who were lesser known. Their names or their rank are not necessarily important, but if they were humble and they were dedicated, and if they felt that the principles that they held dear of preserving life and never taking it from others, then indeed it is indicative that even we who call ourselves spiritualists have a great responsibility upon our shoulders. Some years ago, I used to sing a song which went like this, or the final words, why dream of poppied sod when you can feel their breath, while flower and soul and God knows there is no death. And there is, of course, as we know, only too well. And it is therefore in recognition of not only those who have served, and it doesn't necessarily mean, as the President has said, in the armed services. I think of many in the civil services or even on the land. They all had paid their plot. And it is to those that I, on your behalf, pay my own tribute of thanks. May I say what a privilege has been mine, not only knowing so many of them, but in being given the honour of recalling them for you and myself.
We have with us today a young man who is currently serving in the forces, and so I'd like to ask Gunnar Bradley to pay his tribute in respect of all present servicemen and women.
I am honoured to represent currently serving men and women. I pay a tribute to each and every one of you. I ask you to remember them all in your prayers, whatever their beliefs may be. Thank you.
Is it your mother or your grandma that's at Whitley Bay Church? Your mother? Yeah. So it comes from a spiritualist family, and that family is still serving spiritualism today. And now we come to the lane of the floral tributes. This one is from the Spiritualist National Union as a whole. I'd like to ask Minister Brian Gledhill, who is the president of the Lyceum, which was very active during both World Wars, to lay a wreath on their behalf.
That is the emblem of the Spiritualist Lyceum Union, 7-pointed star.
And I'd like to ask Minister Eric Hatton and Gunnar Bradley to lay their wreath on behalf of all servicemen past and present. Now, would you like to join together, stand and join together and sing the hymn, "O'er the earth the dawn is breaking, angels whisper through the gloom, man from his long sleep is waking, to the life beyond the tomb." over recent weeks, we've heard a lot of news about the activities in Afghanistan and previous to that in Iraq and Kuwait. And a Help the Heroes Fund was launched, and this is doing valuable work. And within the union, up to a few months ago, we had what we called Spiritualist Aid. And the Charity Commission told us that this was out of order, that any funds the unions raised should be used for the charitable purposes of the union and not for giving elsewhere, unless we had a special collection or it was noted specifically what these funds were going to be donated to. So we've wound up the Spiritualist Aid funds, and we've managed to raise the sum, or the balance of it, is £7,203.72, and we thought it would be most appropriate to donate this to the Help for Heroes. We have a representative from Help for Heroes here today, so I'd like him to ask him to step forward while we present the cheque to him. It isn't quite a year since when we had the AGM last year of the union, and at that meeting it was agreed by all members present that, in view of the fact that we could not get representation at the Cenotaph in London on Remembrance Day, it was agreed that we do our own memorial, which we've done, and it's here today. So that's not bad for the union, a year, isn't it? Within a year. Yeah, it takes longer than that to resolve a complaint, I'll tell you. So we can move when we have to move. And I think it's brilliant. And it started with Stephen Upton proposing it, or Minister Stephen Upton proposing it. And then a few of us got together, decided on the design, and the design of it just fell into place. And I think you must admit, it's a credit. It is beautiful. And when you stand in there, the atmosphere is absolutely electric. If you start crying, I've only got one handkerchief. Okay. So I'd like to acknowledge the work that Stephen's done. A lot of it is done on his own. He's had a small team behind him. But we're very proud of you, Stephen, in what you've achieved. It's been hard work. You may be torn your hair out a bit now and again, although it doesn't look too bad. And trying to raise the money. We're still a little way to go to raise the money. So if anybody wants to make a donation towards the National Memorial, well, then you're free to do so. Every little helps. So congratulations, Stephen, and thank you very much on behalf of everybody here and within the union for what you've done. It's also Stella's birthday today, and we aren't going to sing happy birthday and embarrass her, but Stella works alongside Stephen and helps him. So happy birthday, Stella, and I hope that he takes you out of the field tonight. Right. I'd like also to pay tribute and acknowledge the cooperation we've received from the National Arboretum. They've worked very well with us. We've had no problems. They've arranged various things for us, and they've been very good to deal with, very sympathetic, been no problems whatsoever. When they said they were having a field of wildflowers, I was amazed when I walked up here. It's beautiful walking up there. And this is what we're hoping to do at Stansted, but it takes a bit longer at Stansted because we haven't got the gardeners that they have here. But I think you must admit that it's a beautiful setting. They keep it tidy, and there's a lot of hidden monuments around, so the work that they're doing is brilliant. So it's nice to know that we have a national memorial here that people can come to and pay their respects, and it's just off the main road, so nobody can say they're having to go down country lanes to find it. The only problem is you've got a 15 minute walk, unless you've got a pair of wheels and you can do it sooner. So it's thanks to the National Memorial Arboretum people. The stonemasons come from Dis in Norfolk, And Stephen, Judith and I went over there to have a look at the stone for this memorial. And we were absolutely blown away. I've never seen such big slabs of stones in all my life, all laid on end, all different colours, every colour you could imagine. And the chap, I forget his name, Keith, he helped us a lot with the design, showing us the stonework and that. And I think it's a credit to them. I've been looking at the joints and that, and the stonework, and it is, well, it's me being nosy, just seeing if we've got them right, you know. And it's fantastic, and as I say, once it's weathered a bit, it'll take the newness off, but I think they've done a fantastic job, and have been very good to deal with as well. Also like to thank Duncan Thompson, the piper, for being here today, and your music. And the bugler, Adrian Harper. But there's two lots of thanks I have to do. I've got to say a big, big thank you to everybody who has donated towards the cost of this memorial. It's been brilliant to raise over £23,000, is it, in less than a year. It is fantastic. And if we can do it on one occasion, I'm sure we can do it. I'm sure we can do it for if any of our churches in need get stuck for funds. So maybe it's the start of something new, raising money within our own ranks. A bit like the Jehovah's Witnesses do. They build their own churches, we pay people to build them for us. So maybe it's something that we can look at. And Spiritualists are generous, and they've been very generous this time in supporting what is a united cause. I'd also like to thank everybody who has made the effort to come along today. Stephen said earlier this week what the weather's going to be like. He says, you're good at predicting weather. I ain't good at telling fortunes, but I can do weather. And I say, it's going to be sunny with a few clouds and a light wind. And that's exactly what we got. So my guides are working. So we tried to make the conditions pleasant for you. You must admit it's a beautiful place. And I'd like to say thank you very much to everybody for coming along. So I'd now like to ask Minister Dan Annable, Vice President Administrative of the Union, to do the benediction. Dinah.
Father God, we all gathered here today to pay tribute to all those people, whatever they did within any times of conflict. Whatever their job was, we pay tribute to them. They gave their lives so that we could enjoy peace in our time. I think that peace is perhaps a long time coming, but we can always pray and hope that it will arrive at some time. We give thanks to these people who gave their lives for us, because without them, we perhaps wouldn't be here today, and perhaps we wouldn't be paying our tribute to them. I particularly picked up on a couple of lines within the last hymn that we sang, and I think they really say exactly what a lot of us will feel. The words are, and the watchword on our banner, union strong with liberty. It took us a long time to get our liberty. But when we got it, we had to make the most of it. And I think on this sort of thing, we are making the most of our liberty. And I'd like to pay personal tribute to any serviceman in whatever conflict, whether it's past wars or the ongoing wars now, for laying down their lives for us. And I think this obelisk is a very fitting tribute to all those men and women, and I'm sure that you will all agree with me. Father, I ask a blessing on everyone here today and on those people who we have all known, loved and lost. Amen.
Thank you, Diana. That concludes our service, and I wish everybody a safe journey home. stay and enjoy the grounds, have a look round, and take the advantage of the fine weather while it lasts. We'll see most of you next week at Blackpool at the AGM. So you've had a warmer today. You get down to business next week.